The Volvo XC40 is here and we have the India spec review. The Hyundai Creta facelift, so much expectation, all the details. And it's back to the United States for one last time on our freewheeling segment. Almost at the middle of the year and already so much action behind us, and this week has been no different. Welcome to the Car and Bike Show. I'm Siddharth Vinayak Patankar, and we will start off with that new SUV from Volvo. It's a new segment for the brand as well, and boy is it going to set things on fire if it's priced right. This is the new XC40.
Volvo XC40 compact SUV is the Scandinavian company's new baby in every sense of the word. Being new, it gets the very latest development the company has to offer, including a new platform, a new compact modular architecture. And it's literally the smallest SUV that Volvo has ever made. It will arrive in the first week of July in just one trim and with only one engine variant. That will be the D4. 2-litre diesel with 186 bhp and 400 nm of torque, and it'll be dressed in the edgy and racy R design trim. The transmission is an 8-speed. The car takes on the BMW X1, Audi Q3, Mercedes-Benz GLA, and to some extent the Range Rover Evoque and new Lexus NX.
Extremely urban. Very nice looking because it's so distinctive, the styling. There's really nothing else like it in the segment, and I think that's got to be the biggest USP of the XC40, because when you look at it, you think, that looks like no other Volvo, but hang on a second, it also looks like no other compact SUV.
In Volvo speak, the R design badge implies top spec, but more on the sporty than luxurious side. So it's younger, more vibrant, and very attractive as a result. My test car in crystal white metallic looks striking. You also get red or blue options, and Volvo will introduce more colors later.
On the XC40, it's the compact proportions that really are perhaps its big USP, because it's supposed to sit in that segment, remember. So in terms of styling, I think that's the first thing that kind of grabs you. Having the two-tone roof certainly adds to that appeal, because it makes it a little more urban and very contemporary. Very distinctive styling up front. You get the sunken grille, but you also have a slight sunken treatment to the headlamps, which is, again, like I said, distinctive and unlike the other two SUVs, the 60 and the 90. You have the Thor's hammer daytime running light, but it's not quite what we've seen in the fast cars, because the straight line is gone and it's almost arrow-like now. Well, remember, even Thor had to go back and get a new hammer, right, from Nidavilla? I don't know how that's pronounced, because, well, I don't come from that planet. But anyway, the point being that just like he got a new one, looks like Volvo decided to change that around a little bit. A little bit of sculpting in the hood, which is nice, and it kind of stands out with this nice metallic white that I have with me right now. As you start to come around the sides, that's when you start to wonder, how big is this car really? Because it has to deal with the GLA, the Q3, and of course, the current bestseller, the X1. Now, the X1, you think in your head, instantly is the bigger car. But guess what? It's just marginally longer. It's actually not as tall as this one. This one's actually taller. So that's the interesting thing about the dimensions. The car tends to look really compact, but actually isn't as compact as you might think. Very distinctive styling element here with the metal, and also down here, the light-catching element, which is almost sort of buggy-like, dune buggy-like, which is nice because, again, it gives the car lift and that nice urban appeal. The two-tone ends up here, which is distinctive and different. The R design badge kind of accentuates that. And remember, for India, R design is standard. And at the back, you've got the very customary Volvo vertical tail lamp cluster. And yet, it has this little young element thrown into it, makes it again modern, contemporary. And the back, flat, and yet has a little bit of sculpting. The Volvo badging spread across the boot there. And of course, the variant badging as well here at the back.
The XC40 will have all-wheel drive standard. Throttle response and ESP settings change in the off-road mode, but this is not a serious off-roader and it isn't meant to be. Still, it'll give you good approach and departure angles and a generous 211 mm of ground clearance.
Now spend just a few minutes in the XC40 and there's two things that will strike you straight away. The first is this really supple, sorted ride feel that is very comfortable. And the second is how incredibly quiet the car is. In fact, you have to tell yourself it's a diesel at lower RPMs, and when you just get started in the city, sometimes you don't even know it because it's just so refined, the engine. It's a good job they've done on it because it's not just the engine, the fact that it's a diesel and yet it's quiet, but it's also overall sound damping on the car is excellent. You don't get too much feedback from the road in terms of tire noise. You don't get too much wind noise. It's all been really sorted, and the quietness of the cabin, really, that will be a pretty strong USP here in Indian conditions especially.
It is on the road the car will spend most of its time anyway, and there you will be happy with a supple ride quality, good handling and reasonably good power at hand.
You've got eco, you've got comfort, you've got off-road, and then you've got dynamic. For off-road, of course, you have to be at lower speeds and you have to be off-road. And it'll do a little bit of that, though perhaps not as much as something like an Evoque would. But that's not really what you're looking for from a car like this. I have to admit, I have stayed primarily in dynamic. And in dynamic is where things really come to life. Because I'll tell you what, Volvo took a decision to stay four cylinders. You're not going to get massive engines. You're not going to possibly get too much power from this car that you would get from some of the competing cars. But where it loses out some of that punch when it comes to just sheer dynamic performance coming from engine power and torque, it makes up for that in heaps when it comes to overall dynamics, because I have to say that it surprises you just how this car will handle, just how it performs, how it takes to corners. It just stays so very, very stable and in control, and it'll surprise you because, you know, with that smaller engine, you don't expect too much to happen, but it does.
There is a touch of roll at higher speeds, which I did not expect.
It's really nimble and it's quick and it's compact, so it'll maneuver in and out of lanes, it will take to corners very well. One grouse I have though is that when you're in comfort especially, the steering's just really light, it's almost too soft. It's precise enough, but it doesn't give you enough feedback. And even in dynamic, where you expect it to stiffen up, while the rest of the car does, the steering does not, not to the extent I would have liked anyway. And so, to me, that's just a little bit of a niggle, because everything else feels so nice and taut, and the steering just feels a little too soft. The 8-speed gearbox does the job and it's pretty quick too, but I have to say that sometimes it kind of needs to play catch up, because especially when you use the paddle shifters and you want to drop a gear or even go up a gear, and especially when you're at higher speeds, you find that there's that little bit of a jerk because there's a little gap between the gear changes, which is a bit surprising because you don't see that from the gearbox on some of the other Volvo models, but it's not disconcerting and it's certainly not a problem area as such for me.
Being a Volvo, it is ridiculously studded with safety features, so besides multiple airbags, ABS and ESC, and hill descent control, you also get Volvo's city safety functionality, and more.
Now, Volvo decided to pamper us with the R design, and so it's got tons of features, and it's also got tons of techie stuff going on. So I don't just mean the creature comfort gadgets, but even the driver aids. So you've got some of those semi-autonomous features that you've seen in the other Volvo models, and so yes, this has lane keep assist. Yes, it also has pilot assist, which is where you turn it on and the little green steering wheel comes on to the instruments. And you got to keep your hands on the wheel still, but what it'll do is it'll pretty much keep driving in the lane and keep you in the lane. And pair that with adaptive cruise control and you don't even have to bother with the throttle anymore, because of course it will keep track of the traffic in front of you, regulate the speed and keep you in your lane. Now, you'd have to be an idiot to take your hands off the wheel completely, because that's not what this is about, but it certainly helps with cutting down fatigue.
The car has collision alerts and the runoff road feature, it is great to see all of this on offer on the Indian spec car. And if that doesn't impress you enough, the cabin certainly will.
Now, if you thought it was good looking on the outside, well, don't worry, that continues on the inside for sure. And unlike a lot of luxury cars where you start to see this cookie cutter design both on the outside and inside, this isn't a case of small, medium, large. So the XC60 and the XC90 are very different, and the XC40 gets its own distinct appeal on the inside. That whole recessed, sunken theme continues here. So you've got this panel nicely finished. The steering as well has this little sunken logo, and then you've got recesses over here which kind of carry on that theme. A Harman Kardon sound system and the panoramic sunroof, part of the R Design trim, and you've got the R Design badge here as well. That is standard, like I said. The seats, part of that, and so nice sporty stitching on that. Stitching also over here on the gear stick, which is nice and short and stubby, finished in leather, and so is the steering wheel with stitching and leather. Virtual cluster, the sensor system, that's the one thing you want from other Volvos, and so it works just like that. All the driver aid systems and the car information, the cameras, you've got the main menu access, the navigation, and then of course the infotainment settings. Just a few little buttons down here. Drive mode is an important one, and glossy black to kind of finish things off. Now this particular version is finished in black and what Volvo calls lava, which is this nice sort of a woolly carpeting finished in orange. That's really cool.
Even that massive panoramic sunroof is standard. You also get Apple CarPlay, Android Auto, and wireless phone charging capability. The rear is surprisingly roomy for a car this size and will suit most family requirements. The tailgate is electrically operated, the boot is also spacious enough, and the rear seats can be folded down to give you tons of cargo space. But the real fun with this car is when you're out driving it. And that's what it should really all be about, isn't it?
Really high triple digit speeds, and the car never loses its composure, not once. That is what you expect really from a Volvo. And does the XC40 deliver? Oh yes.
The car will launch in the first week of July and will be imported from Sweden. I reckon the price for the one variant only XC40 will sit around 40 lakh rupees. If Volvo can go more aggressive with all that's on offer, it will blow the competition sky high out of the water.
So the new XC40 is loaded with features, and all of that is standard. Like I said, please react to that car, and you'll certainly react to the next one, the Hyundai Creta. What a bestseller it's been for the brand. And so the facelift, well, of course there's lots of anticipation around it. The car looks bigger, more mature, and has lots of new features as well. Ameya and I drove it. Here's our review.
SUVs remain the flavor of the season, and the Creta has led the charge for Hyundai very effectively. In fact, Hyundai has been on a roll. We got the new generation of the Verna, and there have been massive updates to the Grand i10, Accent, and the i20.
Now, this. They have been waiting for it, though we have been, in fact, the customers have been waiting for it for a longer time. And the company has listened to its customers. That's why you have this imposing stance right up front. The cascading grille, of course, is the new family look, which now becomes part of the Creta. The fog lamp housings are now new completely, and these beautiful looking DRLs give it a signature look. There's a new front bumper, and lots of minor changes inside made to the feature list. Overall, it's a dramatic change to what it looked like and what it does now. Here it looks more imposing because of this widish grille. It's actually grown up.
The car looks bigger due to that bold new face, but overall silhouette on the side and tail end remains identical to the pre-facelift Creta. The focus of the upgrade is to keep the Creta relevant, and so a bunch of features have been added. Hyundai has upgraded the level of kit on each variant. It has also cut down on the number of variants on offer. The number has come down to 5 from the earlier 7. But there are no changes to the engine lineup, and of course, the car retains its roomy cabin and boot. The base e-trim retains its standard safety features like dual airbags and ABS, and now also gets driver's seat height adjust and front sliding armrest. The big features, however, are the ones that most people have been waiting for at the top end. A sunroof, cruise control, and a touchscreen infotainment system which comes with connectivity, navigation, and of course, wireless charging. Hyundai says that there are no less than 13 additional features on the Creta, and most of them connect customers to their cars.
What is new is this, what I'm wearing right now. That's wearable, and I think that's what's becoming, that's playing a big role in automobiles right now. And the car industry is just catering and pandering to the needs of the customers. So this one basically tells me everything I want to know about the car via an app on the phone. Of course, you need to synchronize all of it, but very useful and very handy. Also tells me how much I've walked today, which is not much because I've been driving all day.
That smart band will also let you go keyless for the car's operation, of course.
Now, Hyundai has been continuously telling us that it has been listening to customers, trying to understand what features they want, trying to understand what will work in this market and also make the car more competitive. With the Creta facelift, that's exactly what they've done. They've just splashed a whole bunch of features in it. Under the hood though is the same 1.6 litre diesel engine, 1.6 litre petrol and a 1.4 litre diesel. Not much change there. The company says that it has tweaked the performance of the car a bit, but that has not had a dramatic change in any of the figures. So the one I'm driving right now is the diesel, the 1.6 litre diesel, churning out 126 brake horsepower, the most powerful of the lot. And there is also 260 newton meters of torque on offer. It doesn't drive dramatically differently either. The ride is similar to what we've seen before. It actually creases out all the surfaces and takes it in its stride.
Priced between 9,43,000 rupees to 15,04,000 rupees, the Creta facelift is 15,000 rupees more expensive than its predecessor for the base petrol version. Whereas the top spec petrol is more expensive by 57,000 rupees. On the other hand, prices for the base diesel variant remains unchanged, while the top spec variant costs 52,000 rupees more given the tech upgrades. The endless list of features and the fact that an automatic transmission is on offer on both fuel types all point to the Creta likely retaining its king of the hill status, especially with the Kia SP still a year away and the Captur failing to fire for Renault.
Last week, we brought you an exclusive look into the American Center for Mobility's test facility outside Detroit. It simulated highways, open road driving conditions, and even tunnels. This week, we have something slightly different.
From one automated testing facility to another, we are at, as the umbrella suggests, the University of Michigan. We are about to go and have a look at something called M-City, which is an automated car testing facility. And in the only way we seem correct, we're going to take one of their automated shuttles, completely automated shuttles, and we'll have a look at that. So join us for the ride.
But as impressive as the Level 5 automated bus is, the really cool feature here is this. A complete simulated urban environment to test and tune the automated mobility options of the future. From shops to roundabouts to blind intersections, M-City inside the University of Michigan is a perfect testbed to test autonomous mobility without the actual perils and issues caused by testing in real-life conditions. Of course, you can't just use an off-the-road production car, so this is what the university have built. The car in question, a specially outfitted Lincoln MKZ, which is the in-house testbed for the university to test all the future equipment and, most importantly, all the learning software.
We're in the back of a very interesting experimental vehicle here in MCD in the University of Michigan, mm-hmm. joined by the guy who heads the whole department, I guess that's what I can say. Mm-hmm. Tell us more about the vehicle, because it's fitted with a whole bunch of test equipment going straight through the roof, some screens back here, some screens in the front.
Yeah.
So tell me more about the vehicle.
Yeah. So this is really a research tool that's open to many, all the University of Michigan professors, students. So this is really not a production typical vehicle. So we designed the vehicle so that you can easily swap, add more sensors if you want. So when we get this vehicle fully instrumented, it right now it has 5 LiDARs, 5 radars, and 2 cameras. And obviously for a production vehicle, you might be just using, say, 1 camera, maybe 1 or 2 LiDAR, and so forth. So this is really instrumented to the teeth.
Right.
Yeah.
In terms of the actual amount of tech here, what does it cost over a standard vehicle? I'm guessing this is a prototype. It's going to be ridiculously expensive.
It is.
Put a figure on it.
It is. The figure is about $300,000 total. So this is Lincoln MKZ. So the base price is somewhere around $60,000. So another $240,000 for everything else.
The facility simulates other cars driving around, pedestrians, cross-vehicular traffic, and even a train. With the help of radars and LiDARs, the system can detect any obstructions either current or in the near future and can adjust the car accordingly to keep the passengers safest. But it is not only the hardware that is important. Software, and more importantly machine learning, plays a very crucial part in autonomous technology too.
Lots packed in as always on the program, and lots for you to then react to. You can get all the details of what we show you here, both in video and text form, on our website carandbike.com. All the latest reviews and news also right there on our website. You can reach me at Sid Patnikar on Twitter, and please join us next week. Wear your seatbelts, wear your helmets. Bye-bye.